But what we see today is that with alternative currencies like Bitcoin spontaneously emerging, it is now possible through technology that in a generation we won't all be putting our money in a few big mega banks held as liabilities issued out of nothing. Now, I want to propose three things which I think the government can practically do. The first is to continue the present trajectory of reform. After 15 years of studying these matters and now having made it to the Treasury Committee, I'm ever more convinced that there is no way to change the present monetary order until the ideas behind it have been tested to destruction. And I do mean tested to destruction, and it's an extremely serious issue. But it will not change until it becomes apparent that the ideas behind the system are not tenable. Secondly, very much with that in mind, we should strongly welcome what Andy Haldane has said, the chief economist of the bank, that they would commission anti-orthodox research. They will put into the public domain research and analysis which as often challenges as supports the prevailing policy orthodoxy on certain key issues, he said. It is that research which will make possible fundamental monetary reform after the next calamity. Thirdly, we should welcome the Chancellor's recent interest in cryptocurrencies and making London a real centre of financial innovation. Imperfect and possibly doomed as it may be, Bitcoin shows us that peer-to-peer, non-state money is practical and effective. I've used it to buy an accessory for a camera, a perfectly ordinary legal product. It was easier to use than a credit card, and it showed me the price in pounds or any other currency I like. It is becoming possible for people to move away from state money. So what I would like to see is every obstacle to the creation of alternative currencies within the ordinary commercial law removed. We should expand the range of commodities and instruments related to those commodities which are treated like money, like gold, so exempt VAT and capital gains tax, and it should be possible to pay tax in those new monies. And we must not fall into the trap that the United States has fallen into of obstructing innovation. It looks like, in the case of the Liberty Dollar and Bernard von Notthaus, that a man may spend the rest of his life in prison simply for the crime, the supposed crime, of creating reliable money. Finally, Mr. Speaker, we are in the midst of an unprecedented global experiment in monetary policy and debt. It is likely, as Philip Coghlan set out, that this will result in a new global monetary order. Whether it will be for good or ill, I do not know. But as technology and debt advance, I am sure we should be ready for a transformation. Society has suffered too much already under the present monetary orthodoxy.